This is the final part of the series on the defense of Sihon Warehouse. This video will discuss the events that took place after the battle and look at what happened to some of the people that were involved in the battle. If you haven't watched the previous videos, I highly recommend you watch them first, as they will give you an understanding of the battle itself and who the people are. I have included the links in the description. The defense of Sihon Warehouse had been considered a huge success due to the morale boost that it provided. For their actions during the battle, Xie Jingyuan and Yang Ruifu, the two highest-ranking officers at Sihon Warehouse, were awarded the Order of the Blue Sky and White Sun, the second highest award in the Republic of China. Everyone that participated in the battle, both officers and enlisted men, were also promoted by one rank. However, the men of the 1st Battalion were trapped in Shanghai. As they settled into their barracks, they essentially became prisoners in the international settlement. They were disarmed, and their freedom of movement was severely restricted, with men from the White Russian Regiment of the Shanghai Volunteer Corps guarding the camp. Many of the men from the White Russian Regiment had fought during the Russian Civil War and, like the Chinese defenders, could be considered combat veterans. Their role was to conduct daily roll calls of the Chinese troops and to make sure that no Chinese soldier escapes the camp. Over time, the camp that housed the Chinese soldiers became known as the Lone or Isolated Army Camp, reflecting on the fact that this Chinese unit was trapped and unable to leave the Shanghai International Settlement. However, a few of the seriously injured Chinese soldiers were able to initially escape this fate, including the battalion commander, Yang Ruifu. He was taken to the hospital to be treated instead of being held in the barracks, and he was eventually able to leave the international settlement, making his way back to Chinese lines. As for the rest in the camp, they began to settle into a routine. Although stuck inside their camp within the international settlement, life would initially be relatively peaceful for the men of the 1st Battalion. They were to wake up at 4:30 a.m. every morning, with half an hour being given to them to clean themselves and get dressed. Morning exercises were to be conducted between 5 a.m. to 7 a.m. They were then to prepare for the daily roll call at 8 a.m. Breakfast was served at 9 a.m., and military drills and classes were to be conducted at 10 a.m. Between 11:30 a.m. and 2:30 p.m., the soldiers could have lunch, have a break, and also enjoy a bit of free time. At 2:30 p.m., there was to be another hour of drills and training, with dinner being served afterwards at 4 p.m. Between 5 p.m. and 7:30 p.m., the troops did some entertaining activities, such as martial arts, singing, as well as playing games and sports. The men then got a bit of free time before lights out at 9 p.m. The situation would stay like this, with the men undergoing the same routine daily until August of 1938. August 11th was an important day for the men of the 1st Battalion, as 1 year earlier on this date, they, along with the rest of their division, the 88th Division, set out from Wuxi towards Shanghai to defend the city from the Japanese. As the one-year anniversary of this date approached, it was decided that they would hold a flag-raising ceremony within their camp. Days prior to the ceremony, a large flagpole was set up outside the barracks. However, this was not something that the Shanghai Municipal Council was very happy with. The Shanghai Municipal Council was an organization founded in the mid-1800s by Western businessmen and can be viewed as the governing body within the Shanghai International Settlement. An extremely powerful organization controlled by Westerners, the council controlled most of the city's businesses and also the Shanghai Municipal Police. The council also had control of the Shanghai Volunteer Corps, which I had previously touched on. With normal policing work left to the Shanghai Municipal Police, the Shanghai Volunteer Corps was the military force of the international settlement, consisting of not only infantry, but artillery, cavalry, as well as armored car units, and many more. The majority of the men that made up the Shanghai Volunteer Corps were also foreigners, including but not limited to British, American, Portuguese, Russian, and Italian personnel. Although there are a few different versions about what happened next, most sources agree with the following. The Shanghai Municipal Council was afraid that raising a Chinese flag within the international settlement would be seen as provocative by the Japanese, who now controlled the rest of the city. As such, they requested Xie Jingyuan not to raise the Chinese flag on that day. After negotiations, the flagpole was shortened by roughly 8 feet until it was around the height of the barracks roof. The soldiers then went forward with their plans for the ceremony, and at 6 a.m. on the morning of August 11th, the flag of the Republic of China was raised in front of their barracks. According to some sources, the Japanese then lodged a complaint with the Shanghai Municipal Council. Whatever the reason, the Shanghai Municipal Council decided to put a stop to the ceremony. Around 9 a.m., the Chinese were informed that they had to lower the flag immediately. When Xie Jingyuan refused the request, it was decided by the Shanghai Municipal Council to take it down by force. Around 10 a.m., additional units from the Shanghai Volunteer Corps arrived to seal off the area around the barracks and to disperse the civilians there. The job of entering the barracks and taking the flag was given to the White Russian Regiment, who had been guarding the camp. Upon seeing the situation, Xie Jingyuan ordered his troops to protect the flag at all cost. As the Russians rushed into the camp with clubs and batons, a massive melee broke out. The fight would result in 4 Chinese deaths and over 100 injuries of varying degrees. In a few short hours, the Shanghai Volunteer Corps had caused more injuries to the Chinese troops than what the Japanese were able to do in 4 days. However, this incident caused massive outrage among the Chinese population in Shanghai. Strikes and protests were staged, and public outcry was so great that the Shanghai Municipal Council were forced to backtrack on their hardline approach towards the Chinese troops. Visitors were allowed into the camp, and by December, the White Russians guarding the barracks were also replaced by a different unit from the Shanghai Volunteer Corps. However, from now on, the soldiers were only allowed to conduct what they called spiritual flag-raising ceremonies, where although they gathered on the parade ground, no flag was to be raised physically. However, by the end of 1940, things were not looking good for the soldiers. France had surrendered a few months prior, and Great Britain had evacuated all of their army units from Shanghai. Germany, Italy, and Japan had also signed the Tripartite Pact in September. This meant that the Japanese now had even more control over the international settlement in Shanghai, as well as the other foreign concessions in China. A new Chinese puppet government had also been formed, the reorganized National Government of the Republic of China, more commonly known as the Wang Jingwei regime. This puppet government repeatedly made offers to the soldiers in the camp to join them. Although all offers were promptly rejected, there was always the threat that they would resort to violence in an attempt to force the defenders to join their ranks. As time progressed, isolated and constantly facing the threat of disease and being attacked, morale among the Chinese troops began to suffer. Some looked for ways to escape from the camp, while others began to express their dissatisfaction. Xie Jingyuan was mostly successful at keeping the camp together. He forbade any escape attempt from the camp and stressed the importance of unity and following orders in the face of outside threats. However, there were still a few soldiers who were extremely discontent with his leadership. Some had been personally punished by him for infractions, while others saw their commander as the only obstacle between them and their freedom. The tension between Xie and a few of his men finally boiled over on the morning of April 24, 1941. Early that morning, around 5 a.m., as the rest of the men were outside for their morning exercises and drills, 4 men, armed with knives, rushed towards their commander. They were Zhang Wenqing, Long Yaoliang, Hao Dingcheng, and Zhang Guoshun. 2 of them had previously been punished by their commander, while the other 2 acted as accomplices. Hearing the commotion, Shangguan Zhibiao, who had previously been the first company commander during the battle, was the first on the scene. He rushed towards the 4 attackers by himself, and within moments, he had collapsed on the ground, critically wounded, suffering from 5 to 6 stab wounds. By the time the others realized what was happening, it was already too late for Xie Jingyuan. Fatally wounded, he would pass away that same day. Shangguan Zhibiao was rushed to the hospital and faced a long recovery. Although some of the men wanted to execute the 4 attackers on the spot, cooler heads prevailed, and they were eventually turned over to the authorities of the international settlement. Xie Jingyuan's death came as a shock to everyone. With Shangguan Zhibiao recovering in the hospital, command of the men would be passed to Lei Xiong, who had previously been the machine gun company commander during the battle. Days after, a funeral was held for Xie Jingyuan, which was attended by thousands of people. Some also believed that Xie's death had been organized by the Chinese puppet government, who, after seeing his unwillingness to join them, decided to get rid of him. Interestingly, however, some sources also state that it would be the same puppet government that would put those responsible for Xie's murder on trial, with the sentences for the 4 attackers ranging from life imprisonment to death by hanging. Within months after Xie Jingyuan's death, Japan would be at war with the Western nations. Japanese troops marched into the international settlement and took control of the Chinese soldiers. They were transported to various places to do labor, but a number of them were able to escape back to Chinese lines. Some would be liberated at the end of the war in 1945, although unfortunately, others would pass away before they were freed. After the war, many of the survivors would return to Shanghai, where they reconnected with each other and paid their respects to their fallen comrades and commander. Although all of those who participated in the battle have already passed away, their stories would continue to live on, and they would always be remembered as heroes who were willing to put their lives on the line to protect their country.